So red salute to all. I hope all of you are good at home. These are very difficult times, and our difficulties are being extended. Our difficulties are being doubled by the kind of situation in which we are being thrown today. So it's not one battle that we are fighting today. It's multiple battles that we are fighting today. It's the battle of our life, it is the battle of our livelihood, it is the battle of all sorts of other things that actually enhances our life, our lifestyle, our livelihood, etc. So today, as I am asked to speak on the national education policy, I would like to go to the national education policy and how it is influencing, impacting our lives today and for the future generation. We would discuss some of these aspects in the national education policy. Before starting, I would like to extend my red salute and revolutionary greetings to this page, comrade. This page has initiated a lot of discussion on a lot of important issues, and I keep on following the page. Some of these discussions are really helpful in order for us to sort of shape up our understanding, our political understanding. It's in a way giving us an opportunity for political education. So thank you so much, comrade, for giving me the opportunity so that I can share some of my views on the national education policy. I'd also like to mention that in this page, Professor Surajit Majumdar had already taken a session on the National Education Policy 2020. And I listened to that session as well. And it was very elaborate, very comprehensive talk for us to understand the National Education Policy. So I don't know if in terms of content, I'm going to contribute much to that what Professor Surajit has spoken already. But nevertheless, I would like to highlight a few aspects which are particularly important for the India's primary education. Why primary education? Because primary education is a backbone which sort of make the whole education system stand. But today, the onslaught has come into our pre-primary education, our primary education, our secondary education, our higher education. So the university that where I'm studying, the Jawaharlal Nehru University, in past few years, we have seen severe onslaught on education. A lot of time, you know, the right from the fee hike to distracting the institutional models, the democratic models within the institutions, and so on and so forth. A lot of policies have been forced into our universities. And what we are seeing and battling in our university system is also to do with the primary education system and the pre-primary education system. And this policy, the way this policy has come, first of all, that needs to be understood, that why it was brought in such a hurry without any discussion. I mean, India has a very good enriched system, the federal structure, where, you know, every states are empowered to give, you know, their opinion, their suggestions, their criticism, their agreements. All of that have been bypassed. This policy has not been discussed in the parliament. It's, we believe that, you know, it's a violation of the constitution, because this policy also sorts of replace certain bodies, for example, University Grant Commission, which came through the University Grant Commission Act, which is supposed to be discussed within the parliament, but this policy was not being discussed in the parliament. This policy has been slapped, it's been imposed on us by the Union Cabinet, without having this democratic process being taken in place. We believe that this is a severe onslaught on the constitutional structure, our federal system, and so on and so forth. This shows actually the nature in which the government is operating today. And therefore, much of the things that are said in this policy For example, this policy talks about equity. The policy talks about affordability, accessibility, flexibility. These terms have been used in a very sort of, the terms have been romanticized. It has been used in this policy. However, we need to understand what are the intentions. So maybe for a lot of us, if we look at this policy, it might sound like this is the best policy ever. And that's how the campaign is going on, to project this policy as the best possible policy, not only in India, but throughout the globe. But if you analyze this policy clause by clause, in each clause, through each clause, this policy is basically attacking the backbone of Indian education system. So in that regard, this policy is not to be considered as the National Education Policy 2020, but this policy has to be considered as national exploitatory policy, national exclusionary policy, because this policy, if we can very broadly characterize or broadly put out the points of what this policy is actually all about. This policy is exclusionary. This policy is elitist. This policy is anti-poor. This policy is anti-reservation. This policy is anti-women. This policy is anti-student and teacher. And hence, this policy is anti-education. So when I'm saying that, you know, this policy has all this character, why I'm saying that this policy is having all this character? It is not that, you know, it is only bringing the privatization, the commercialization of education into Indian education system, but it is actually attacking the Indian education system as a whole, the whole character, the democratization, the institutional character, and the education for what the education has been visionized. This whole system has been attacked by this policy framework. So if we sort of go back to this policy on and you know how the policy has come into place, on July 29 this policy has been approved, right? But on May 1st the Prime Minister had actually talked about this policy. He reviewed the policy. And while reviewing the policy, he mentioned that the online education will be the heart of the policy, is the heart of the policy. Now, during the pandemic, a lot of aspects about online education has come. I'm not going too much into detail of those aspects because already there are a lot of reports which show that, you know, because of this online education, which has been pushed by different governments without any preparation and so on, this is actually creating a massive havoc. A lot of students are not being able to access education and so on. But what the Prime Minister said on 1st May, he said that this online education is in the heart of the policy with two basic objectives. The first objective was to improve the quality of education, and the second objective was to reach the standard of global, to reach the global standard. Now, if we look at these two aspects that the Prime Minister has talked about, we must question that, you know, the quality that the government, the Prime Minister is talking about, whether there is any data, whether there are any evidences which show that online education is necessarily going to improve the quality of education. There is no such data revealed by the government. There is nothing available. It's just merely in terms of rhetoric, certain high sort of, high statements are being given without giving any sort of basis of it. Secondly, when we are talking about the global standard, we must ask this question that what are these global standards? Who are setting this global standard? Because we need to understand that a lot of time when these global standards are being set, it is set by a set of bodies which comprises mostly of people who are coming from a certain background, which do not have representation from diverse background people. but those policies, those standards are being set by people who have a very exclusionary vision of education. So we need to ask that, you know, who are the people who are going to set this global standard? And thirdly, what do these global standards mean? Who are the people who are going to be benefited out of this global standard? Now, if we ask this question, we would clearly understand that this policy with these two visions that Mr. Prime Minister spoke about actually indicates of, you know, not any quality of education, not any standard of education, but it essentially sort of makes road for the strategies and the plan which have been already done by the World Bank. So in, you know, many experts have already pointed out this. Professor Anil Sadgopal made a very interesting point in one of his recent article, which was published in The Frontline. And I would suggest that everybody who are watching and who are interested to follow up on national education policy should read this issue released by The Frontline, which has a lot of aspects, which has a lot of, you know, articles on the NEP. So in this article, he basically points out, and I would like to quote him. He says that, you know, shortly after the Prime Minister's announcement, the Chief Executive Officer of Google announced a major investment in Mukesh Ambani's Reliance Industries. Now, why is it significant here when I'm talking about and I'm quoting him? It is because the Google CEO announcement was followed by a marketing agency's report, which stated that online education would have a market worth $15 billion in the next 4 years. So you see, the plan has been already set. There is already a market-driven approach, and you know, people, the market is already investing, seeing that, you know, this system is not to improve any education system and so on, but only that, you know, what kind of profit it will generate for the market to sustain. So the Prime Minister clearly has no sort of vision for the improvement of the quality of education, but it is simply a brazen conspiracy by the World Bank, by the corporate lobby, by our today's ruling government to impose the national education policy, making inroads for the private companies to set their business in the in schools, in higher educational institutions within the Indian education system. Now, if we go back to what does it look like in the primary education system, there are a few things which are mentioned. I mean, which again, on the face, it would look that it's a great advancement, because earlier, in the earlier system, the children from age 6 years to 14 years were to pursue education. Now it has been, the time period has been extended. So from basically 3 years to 18 years, children would be coming under the education. So from 3 years it has started. And this pre-primary education system, I mean, the pre-primary education system has been now divided into four broad categories. So in village level, there would be the pre-primary education has been also linked with the Anganwadi system. So in the village level, you will have, say, primary education school with Anganwadi school. Then there will be in the district level, small town level, there would be schools which will be low budget schools. Then there will be government schools, like we have central schools, we have Navodaya Vidyalaya, etc. And then there will be the private school, which will have a lot of facilities, whose fees will be really, the amount will be really huge, and so on and so forth. Now, if we see today, if we compare this structure with our present system, what do we see? What do we see in our small town? I come from a small town from Assam, and what I experienced, I know that this is a shared experience that many people would have had in their, you know, in their towns, in their village, in their regions, and so on. So we see that, you know, some schools are having, you know, a certain standard. They are able to provide good education, whatever. Some other schools' performance, you know, relatively is poor. And some other schools are performing very poor. Now, what is this? What does that mean? Usually, generally, this has been injected in our minds, the way we sort of compare the schools. We tend to say that, you know, these schools are not good. Government schools are not good. Private schools are good. The education is good in that school, so on and so forth. Why is it the case that the government system, government schools, the performance is poor? It is poor because the amount of resources they require, they don't get. And the amount of resources and so on, the private school is accessing. The government schools do not have those resources. Now, to link the schools, pre-primary schools, with the Anganwadi system, what does that mean? We know already the Anganwadi workers are taking a lot of burden. They are doing exceptional work in terms of health, in terms of giving additional care to the children when they are coming to school, etc. Now, this set of teachers will be made to also give teaching to the children, and there won't be sufficient training given to them. So the school, the children who would be going to these schools, there are more chances that this school, the teachers will be overburdened, will not be able to give the proper amount of teaching and care which is needed. And the students also will not be able to get. And who are the people, who are the students who actually go to the Anganwadi schools? It's the student who will not be able to pay huge amount of fee, who will not be able to afford a private education school. So in one hand, you will be having students who would go to, say, Anganwadi, who would go to, you know, low budget private school, where they would not get equal facilities, resources, and so on. And they will be made to compete with the students who would be having access to, say, digital classroom, smart classroom, their blackboard, from their bench to blackboard, everything will be digitalized. They will be given a lot of resources and so on. And why I'm saying that this set of students will be competing with the students of this, high-five private schools, is because they have introduced a national level test at the third standard. So now, till you go to the 12th standard, you have to basically pass 5 tests. One in the 3rd standard, then 5th standard, then 8th standard, then 10th standard, and then 12th standard. So this is the process in which you have to go. Now, if you look at the RTE Act 2009, the RTE Act 2009 has identified that this problem, this system is problematic, because it is creating a lot of burden, exam-driven burden, to the students at this age. Therefore, the RTE Act 2009 mentioned that in 8 years, there won't be any exam. Whereas this policy pushes for national level exam, which will be starting from the third standard. Now, we already know the amount of inequality persists in our society. We know that, you know, who are the people who would be able to pay fee, who can access, say, private school and so on. We know all this. These are all clear things before us. With this sort of gradation, there is also a clause which says that, you know, each of the private government school will be linked to at least one private school, which means that you will basically share the resources. In less resource, they are going to run 2 schools. The resource will be shared, as in the teachers will be shared. There won't be more recruitment and so on. We know that how, you know, the privatization model, the privatization is actually not providing, sufficient resources, but trying to sort of manage with very less amount of resources. So it is going to put a lot of burden to the already burdened government schools. Not only that, along with the private schools, there would be such certain rules which will be imposed. We know that, you know, there has been already, an aspect which is very closely related with the private corporate model, which is called disciplining. This disciplining would be even more harshly put and pushed within the government schools, which is also very dangerous. So when students come to the secondary education, has to pass so many examination, national level examination, which would not be, which would not happen on the same platform. Like the students will not be given same opportunity, and therefore they won't be asked for giving exam. Rather, they would be put into different platforms in an unequal platform, and they would be expected to clear the exam. Now, in this system, if you observe and if you look at the policy carefully, the policy did not mention a single time about the need of reservation, about reservation, not even in the advanced standard. Now, why it is the case? The policy's highlight was mainly on the merit-based education system. If you see this merit-based education system, and it's often asked, I mean, it's a very old debate where people keep on accusing that why there should be reservation, why, you know, education should not be on the merit and so on. We need to actually put this question, what merit you are talking about? You are talking about merit where your system is eliminating the students who are coming from socially disadvantaged section in class third standard. Third standard, a large number of students are getting eliminated. If some people manage to secure the pass mark qualifying the national level entrance, in fifth standard, eighth standard, 10th standard, 12th standard, there are so many standards where because of not equal opportunity, they are getting eliminated from the education system. And after that, because in the present situation, now in the present situation, if we look at data, less than 6% of the students who come from socially disadvantaged section qualifies or clear class 12. Now with this policy in place, there would not be even 1% student who would be able to qualify class 12. So reservation comes under after class 12. So there is no reason for reservation. The policy clearly does not mention about reservation. So basically, you are talking about a merit-based system, eliminating more than 95% of students from your education system. And then you are talking about merit. So it will be only the meritocracy criteria that the policy indicates, and you know, the people, particularly from the privileged section, the argument that they give is basically something which, first of all, does not recognize the historical deprivation that certain section of our society is undergoing. Secondly, at a very preliminary stage, a large number of this section has been eliminated. So, and thirdly, now their demand is that do away with reservation altogether. So it's a very, very exclusionary policy from that length. And, you know, when we are talking about this, this policy talks a lot about multidisciplinary approach. It talks about multiple entry and exit option and so on. On the face, it may look like that, you know, multidisciplinary is a very good thing. Well, multidisciplinary approach is a very good thing, provided the intention is clear, the intention is good, and the implementation is happening properly. What it means under this policy and the record under which this government has been performing is this, that multidisciplinary is not actually bringing any opportunity for the students. It is rather creating the students, I mean, they are talking about multidisciplinary approach in one hand, then on another hand, they are saying about the skill-based education system, where you know you will be given a lot of option to study, but there won't be any thorough knowledge. You can drop out after 1 year of degree, where you will get a general mere qualification. It would not give you a certificate for the entire course. So basically, this policy is creating you, is making you accept that you are going to be a member of the cheap labor market, where your labor will be exploited and you will not be in a position to demand other anything else, because you would not be having a proper certificate for a entire degree course. And this has been done also. I mean, US model has been quoted thoroughly in this policy, particularly in case of higher education, that the policy, the education system has to reach the world-class university standard and so on and so forth. But what this world-class university standard, that particularly the US model that they're quoting, it is going to only invite more and more inequality in our society. It is going to create a cheap labor market where the students will be forced to go and become, say, a waiter in a cafe or a hotel. Now, I'm not saying that that's not a good job or that's a worthless job, but I'm saying, say, for example, you want to study, you want to become a professor of a university, or you want to teach in a college, or you want to go and do something else. You want to become a musician, you want to become an engineer, you want to become a doctor. All these opportunities will be in a way closed, because a large number of people will be made to accept the terms for this cheap labor market that the policy is intending to create. Now, with all these different aspects, another aspect which has come into a debate recently, I mean, it's an important debate, because in India we have seen that in last few years they're trying to project a model for the whole of India, which is called Hindi Hindu Hindustan. Now, with this policy, there are certain interesting aspects which just sort of implement this agenda of Hindi, Hindu, and Hindustan. The policy, if I may quote from clause 411 to 423, the policy talks about multilingualism and the power of language. It basically wants to project that, how they are sensitive, how they are caring about India's diversity and so on and so forth. But essentially, it attacks India's diversity, nothing else. If we look at that three language formula which this National Education Policy 2020 is pushing, it says the medium of instruction will at least until at least grade 5, but preferably till grade 8 and beyond, will be the home language or mother tongue, the local language or regional language. Thereafter, the home language or local language shall continue to be taught as a language wherever possible. Now, and it has a subclause, clause 4.18, which highlighted that the importance of Sanskrit, Sanskrit language system, and it says that Sanskrit will be offered at all levels of school and higher education as an important enriching option for students, including as a mainstream option in the three language formula. Now, what does these clauses mean? I mean, if you look at India's diversity, there are so many languages. I mean, there are, I think it's a little old report, but the census, I mean, 1991 census only pointed out that in India, there are 114 languages. I mean, now the record, the number would be different. But our census, this 2021 census is going to come. The number would be varied, but even in that old number, you see 114 languages, total 216 language and mother tongue, 18 scheduled languages, 96 non-specified in the schedule. So there are so many languages, and within each categories, there are so many varieties. There are so many dialects. In Hindi has been clubbed you know, many languages have been clubbed under Hindi. 48 languages have been clubbed under Hindi, including, you know, the dialect or mother tongue like Awadhi, Bhojpuri, Garhwali, etc., etc. Now, if we look at that, you know, what is going to be this three language formula, how they are going to implement this three language formula. Three language formula is going to invite a dominant language discourse in our education system. How it will happen? It will happen because, say, 48 languages are clubbed under Hindi. So if, I mean, if they're able to project that, you know, the most number of people, more than 33 crore people are the Hindi speakers, but they're not going to grant all the other different languages which have been clubbed under Hindi. Like, you can't have education in Bhojpuri, you can't have education in Awadhi. Like that, you can't really have education in your mother tongue. It will all be clubbed under this Hindi, which will make a sort of hegemony. The dominant language discourse will be brought in by this, you know, three language formula. And then when we come to Sanskrit, what does it mean? I mean, Sanskrit, according to the 1991 census only, that more than 5 crore people were Tamil speakers, more than 3 crore people were Malayalam speakers, and so on and so forth. So if and the census also showed that, you know, only about 50,000 people are Sanskrit speakers. So the question is, when the policy is sort of saying that, you know, the Sanskrit language has to be the language, the importance has to be given and so on, special funds have been allotted for Sanskrit. The question is, why not for others? Why not for Tamil? Why not for Malayalam? Why not for many other languages? What? So the intention is very clear that, you know, they want to implement this RSS Hindutva agenda of Hindi, Hindu, Hindustan on us, and this is eventually going to be accepted by all the states, all the South Indian states, all the states from the Northeast, and so on and so forth, and going to accept, you know, one set of language as the language of the education system. It is a blatant attack on the diversity and actual multilingualism in our country. And the last aspect that I would like to talk about the language is that they are talking about three language formula, right? In that, there is no special mention or that, I mean, the English language teaching has been completely eliminated. Now, it might look that, you know, English language, why would a student learn about English? It's an elitist approach. Many people can argue that it's a colonial approach and so on and so forth. But practically, if we see that, you know, the market, if you go and face an interview and so on and so forth, your whatever talent, your articulation is all going to be determined by how well or how bad you speak English. Now, you see, in the school education system, who are the students who will be getting access to the English education? It is only the students who would be going to the private schools, big schools, who would be getting this sort of an exposure. I mean, I come from a Bangla medium school, so I know that there were certain difficulties till a certain level that I had to face. I was not able to compete just because my language skill was not that much in English. And, you know, afterwards, it was a long struggle to get to learn the language, get to speak the language, and then ultimately have the communication in that language. And a lot of things that happened afterwards, dependent on how well or how bad I learned the language. So, and our the nature of the market today, the job market and so on, it is determined by how good or how bad you speak English. Now, the students who would be going to, Anganwadi school and so on, who would not be given any exposure to this language, they would be made competing with the students who would be going to the private schools and so on and so forth, who will be learning these languages. So the chances of these students, the students who are studying in government schools, who are studying in their own medium, the chances of them getting eliminated entirely from the education system and later from the job market is much more higher, which the national education policy today, the already inequal system in our society, it is paving path for the more and more inequality which will be coming in future. So this, in our opinion, is not only going to bring the sort of commercialization and privatization into education, but it is a big, big onslaught on India's diversity, the constitution, the way we see the federal system. So I would stop here, and if there are any questions, then I can answer those questions. Thank you. I can't see any questions. If there are not any questions, yeah, I can't see any question. Probably I'm missing out on seeing any question. So I think that some of the aspects on the pre-education, primary education system I have covered. I would urge that all of us who are interested about education, who understand the importance of education, because education has, I mean, how the Indian education system has been visioned earlier after independence, was also to do with education as a powerful tool to sort of change a lot of things in the society. It is a powerful tool of also because it gives us courage and power to talk against any kind of oppression. And today, because a lot of, I mean, whenever we raise voice in education institution, for example, it is being told by the ruling class, the ruling force today who is ruling the country, that education institution is not for politics. And this is one argument which has been consistently given by the privileged class, is only because that education is giving you power, education is giving you confidence to speak against certain injustice which has been persisting in our society for long. So it is our duty and responsibility today to safeguard the education and to safeguard education from the severe onslaught that the government is slapping on us. So with that, I would like to conclude this session. Thank you all for having patience and watching it for so long. It's already past dinner time for many, but it was a very nice experience to talk to you all. Thank you. In clubs in the world, let's salute.